Shall we start?
So, welcome to our research seminar. This should be the first seminar in this academic year. And today we have a special guest, Koen Schoors, professor of economics at the Ghent University. Professor Schoors has a lot of very interesting publications in top journals. And today he will present one of his research papers. So, Koen, you're welcome.
Спасибо. It's a very strange feeling to be here. It's the first time I'm presenting for a room I know everybody except one person, that's you. All the others I know by name. No, actually you also, yeah. There's two persons I don't know. There's still two persons I don't know. So it's usually never like this. So it feels like home anyway. I could even do it in Russian, but that's bad for you guys, so I'll not do it in Russian. It's also strange because it's the first time in Russia I present a paper not about Russia. It's going to be a paper about Flanders, where I live. However, it's about institutions. And that should appeal to you all, because it's definitely about, it's definitely an institutional paper. If you have any questions about me being unclear or something you want to clear up before continuing, please do so immediately. So don't hesitate, just jump in. So we're going to talk about land rights, local financial development, and industrialization in Flanders. And it's going to be actually mainly the 19th century. So we're going to work on the 19th century. Voilà. So why is that interesting? Well, Flanders, actually Belgium, was the first country on the continent to industrialize. We all, of course, know very well from our history classes that industrialization happened in the UK. But the first country after the UK in the continent was Belgium. So we were a front-runner in industrialization, and we are still a very industrialized country today. However, that industrialization happened in the south of Flanders, the so-called Walloon region, which is today the poor region. It happened not at all in Flanders, which today is the rich region. So Flanders actually largely kept a kind of proto-industrial or even rural character. And what do I mean by proto-industrial? There was a lot of household industry. So people in farms producing textiles, producing artifacts. And it's called the putting out industry. So you had people putting out materials to households, the households manufacture something, and they bring it back. And so it's like a distributed factory almost. We call this the proto-industry. Until 1848, which this is a time of a major financial crisis in Europe. Not in Russia, I think, at the time, but there was a massive financial crisis in Europe, a lot of bankruptcies of banks, a big, big recession. Until then, Flanders was basically pretty much like Russia in a sense, well, different in many ways, but comparable in a sense, very rural, very proto-industrial. And then only after this big, big recession in 48, 49, we see slowly a non-agricultural development. It's slowly taking off, and we see industrialization. So basically we see activities in commercial and industrial enterprises, not farms. And that's what we're going to measure. And that leads to actually a very wide divergence in 1910, prior to World War I. So what we're going to do is we're going to look how things change from very early on, 1846, till 1910. So we take more than 50 years of industrialization, and we see how it changes. And we see how it is affected by land rights and by financial development. That's the idea of the paper. Just to show you this early industrialization. Well, you see, so this is actually provinces. We do have locality data, but for 1846, we don't even have locality data. We don't know how many commercial firms and industrial firms existed in 1846. It's just no data on it. But we know it on the province level. And this is the Flemish provinces, all of them. And you see total employment and industry as a percentage of total workforce. And you see in 1846, so the beginning of our sample, data window, you see 9%, 7%, 11%, 9%, 7%, very close to each other and very low. But then you see, over time, by 1910, you see big differences. Those two regions, West Flanders and Limburg, being on the high side, actually, initially, this one, do not change. This region, after 50 years of evolution, more, it's still the same. And here it's still the same, more or less. You have then some regions that do comparably well, Antwerp. There's quite some industrialization. But then you have Brabant and East Flanders, where I live. And they are actually on the very low side initially, and this relatively low still. And they do very well by the end. So while in the beginning the differences are very small, here it's almost double, right? So there's much more variation. And this is on the province level. What we have actually is data on in 1910, not in 1846, but in 1910, we have data on the locality level. We have 1,205 localities. So little villages, little cities, where we know from the census exactly how many firms there are in commerce and industry, which type of industry actually, we don't use it yet, and also how many people work there. So that's what we're going to exploit. So basically, the main dependent variable is going to be at the locality level, what is the industrial employment share as a percentage of total workforce. This variable, but at locality level, it looks, I will show you a map later. What is the main hypothesis of the paper? The main hypothesis is there's a kind of de Soto effect, Hernando de Soto effect. We're going to say this economic divergence is across these localities is driven by the Soto effect. What is the idea? Okay, Napoleon arrives with his armies after the French Revolution. He wipes out the southern low countries, but then it's not Belgium yet. Belgium is only since 1830. It doesn't exist before that. And Napoleon installs uniform land rights and a cadastre. And then you have local variation in rural land prices before. But now all at once, these rural land prices become collateral. So become variable. On top of that, you get some formal credit institutions installed by 1880. And what they basically say, the implication of de Soto would be the industrialization in 1910 is not only a function of land values in that locality or financial development in that locality, but of the interaction. Those localities with higher land values and better local financial development, they should especially industrialize. Because in those localities, you have collateral and you have the access to finance, so you can use the collateral to get loans. That's the idea, right? That's the story. So let's look at the main dependent variable. This is the industrialization in 1910, and the darker it is, the more industrialization you have. And it's actually here in employees per 1,000 inhabitants, so it's per 1,000 capita, and the highest one is 242, the lowest one is between 0 and 100. It's badly readable in this projection, but it goes from very little to very, very dark. So here you have a very, very dark part. So the variation we saw on the province level, remember on the province level, the highest number was actually 15. Now here it's 24. So on the locality level, you have of course much more variation. The province is always an average. So this is the main dependent variable. Land rights. So now you understand the whole idea. We're going to look at how land values and early financial development lead to industrialization in Flanders. And I showed you the main dependent variable on the map. Now let's look at land rights. Of course, you all know property rights are a social construct. It's not a law, it's something in our heads. It's a social construct. It's a kind of consensus in society of how assets should be used, sold, how you should deal with them, how you should transfer them. And it's something humans have thought of. Animals have no property rights. They have control rights. I have the banana, so you don't have the banana, and we could fight over it. But that's a control right. That's not a property right. A property right has a whole set of rules and habits and regulations of how to deal with these assets, how to use them, how to transfer them. So what does it mean to have uniform, homogeneous land rights? It means, first of all, land is exclusively assigned. We call this freehold land. So it's land you can sell, you can buy, you can change, you can put a building on it, you can do whatever you want with it. It's opposed to usufruct land. Usufruct land is land you can use, you can have the produce of the land, but you cannot sell the land, which was actually the case in Russia till 2004 in agriculture. you could not sell land. Secondly, you need a demarcation of the parcels. You need a cadastre. So you need somewhere a register. It's usually the state that does it, almost always the state that does it, where every little parcel is described in very little details that you know exactly what a piece of land precisely is. You need also legal institutions. Because you can have a cadastre, but if you don't have legal institutions to deal with disputes, it's useless. So I could come to any one of you and say, hey, that's my land. And you say, no, it's my land. And I say, you want to fight for it? No, we go to court. And the judge will go to the cadastre and it's somewhere on paper. It's yours or mine. And you can't fiddle around with it. So it's not a matter of power or control, it's a matter of the law. And you have a legal system that actually enforces the law. And last of all, very important, it's a system of rules and contracts. Land rights also imply, for example, the idea of mortgages. The idea of, because mortgages imply, implies a whole system where if I want the credits, there is an arranged set of regulations, somewhere there's an office, we can go, I can pledge my land, I can get the credit. If I don't pay back the bank can get my land without any trouble. They can sell it. That's not a whole set of rules and contracts. If it's not in place, your land is not going to be economic capital because it will not lead to increased lending. And so we got all of this as a little present from Napoleon. In a way you could say, you shouldn't have defeated Napoleon. Not so quickly at least. We defeated him also, but it took us longer. So land rights in the South and Low Countries. Basically, they existed. So actually, in that sense, we're very different from Russia. Land right existed back till 1400. So we didn't have the mir and the communal land system and all that stuff. We had individual land rights, but it was very, very heterogeneous. So land sales were officialized often by a notary, by alderman benches, manorial courts, all kinds of special local, but very local institutions. They had no value. If you sell the land to an outsider or 15 villages further, it has no value anymore. So local ways of making notes, local ways of making databases, but not regional or national at all. Sometimes there were even official surveyors tracing the boundaries, so trying to measure the plots, but again, in a small circumscription. Maybe an abbey has all the plots well circumscribed, but then go a bit further and it's again not present. So it's dependent on local initiative, local lords, local institutions, no universal system at all. Which means there is a land market, but there's no credit market that is based on land at all in Flanders. Land rights were also very incomplete. Often different rights coexist over the same line. So you can have all kinds of conflicts. Often you have, you call it neutral property and usufruct property. Someone has the land, someone else can use the land until the other person dies, this kind of stuff. Often you have a monarch of a local lord who gives a domain in fief to a vassal. So that's his subject. And the vassal can use some of it and then himself give it to a copyhold. The copyhold is then maybe a small farmer, and the small farmer works on the land and does this stuff, and he has to pay a little bit to the vassal, and the vassal has to pay a little bit to the his lord. But this copyhold in many cases could even sell the land. So in the local village, in many cases, not the case in Russia, but in local villages, people could sell land to each other. Because it was all the same vassal, the same lord. So there was a kind of informal land market and people accepted the control rights, but it also meant that you cannot use it for credit markets. So there's no central registration and often land was remortgaged several times. So they tried to, not remortgage, they tried to get a credit and they promised, I will give you my land, but it's not a mortgage because you can do it as many times as you want. There's no control. The lord can always ask it back. The vassal can always ask it back. So it's a mess. It kind of works, but it's a mess. I mean, like real life, right? Real life, it kind of works, but it's a mess. And that was the land rights system in Belgium. And then came Napoleon, Vive Napoleon. We were annexed in 1795, and he immediately destroyed the old system. So the prerogatives of the nobility and the church were abolished. and they never returned, as opposed to Russia, where they remained. Also, the old land structures were completely abolished. And Napoleon set about on creating a new system right away, which we still have. Even, I don't mention it here, but even our legislation, the Belgian whole legislation structure, and even the constitution, is based on the Code Napoleon. So we have a very Napoleonic system in a way, which was in many ways very liberal. So there is now a straightforward division between freehold land and usufruct land, and nothing else. So all these, you have all kinds of other special rights, so that you can use the land, but you have to give one tenth of the produce to the lord in these conditions, and you have to give some free labor in these conditions, and that's a property right. All this stuff, it's all gone. It's just usufruct, freehold, and nothing else. There was an official land registry immediately established. 1 year after the next, they established the cadastre. And it was operational from November 1802, where you could actually sell and buy land officially, as opposed to Russia 2004. So there's a time gap here. In that sense, Flanders is interesting to study because it's one of the first countries to do this. So they register ownership limitation of each plot. They value all the plots by 1834. Belgium was founded in 1830. So at the moment Belgium was founded, immediately after we had a fully working land ownership system with a fully full cadastre with every plot described.
Just for clarification, and what language was used for that?
French. Yes. So it used to be French speaking. It's the French part that industrialized, and now it's turning Flemish speaking. So the country is changing. Of course, after Waterloo, Napoleon leaves, but the land rights, they stay. That's a big difference in Russia. Napoleon leaves, but the land rights do not stay. Well, actually, they do stay. They stay Russian. I mean, the Napoleonic land rights stay. So maybe if he could have just stayed for two more winters, we would have a very different history. Who knows? So these are the land prices in 1846. You already see it's very different from the civilization picture, right? The bluer, the more valuable. You will see it's the land price in 1846. This is precisely before the whole thing starts. So in 1846, Flanders, I showed you this data, is still completely agricultural. There's no industrialization. So we take this as a starting point. And we're going to think of this as exogenous. The value in 1846 cannot be caused by the industrialization in 1910. So we're going to take this as a way of to establish causality. It's, we take early land values, we don't care about all the rest that happens later, and we're going to look how these early land values, before any industrialization, determine later industrialization. Okay? That's the idea. So we have land, land rights, land prices, fine. But we also need financial development, banks. Now, we also did have financial development in the early 19th century. You had a whole load of private banks, at some point 16 private banks. Some of these banks created their own money. So we had a free banking period with banks making their own money, like in the US. And there's no central bank. We had no central bank initially. So the banks, they create their own, they are their own central banks, and they compete. And they have exchange rates for the monies. Crazy, but actually it happened in many countries, so we've forgotten history. And the main goal of these banks was to collect savings in Flanders and finance industrialization in the Walloon region, which makes sense. That's the whole point of banks. It's rechanneling savings to investments. And all the investments were at the moment in the Meuse-Basin. And why in the Walloon region? Early industrialization evolved not about access to ports, it evolved about access to coal. And the mines are in the Walloon region. So that's why we got industrialization. And that's what was very developed. But later on, having coal mines didn't matter anymore because there was much cheaper coal in day mines in Australia or the US. And it became important to be close to a port because we import the coal. And now coal isn't important at all anymore. But initially, so it was having the coal. So it happened in the Walloon region. They had the mines. And then you had a massive financial crisis in 48, 49 with all... there was a first one in 1938 actually, and all the big banks went bankrupt. They had Société Générale, they had the Banque de Belgique, and they died essentially. So they were saved by the government, as usually happens in these cases. Governments tend to save banks to stabilize the system. But what was the reaction of the government? The reaction of the government was, first of all, no more free banking. We establish the National Bank of Belgium and they will issue the currency. So since then we have a national bank. Actually, now we don't anymore, we now have the ECB, right? But before the ECB was the National Bank of Belgium. And immediately, as a reaction to the crisis, there was a ministerial plan to have a public saving banks, already in 1849. So there was a plan to have a Belgian Sberbank, which was a publicly owned bank, and it would set up offices anywhere. But then there was a lot of opposition against the plan. The Catholic Party basically said, no, we believe in free initiative, and they are conservatives, no state involvement, that's too communist. And so there was a lot of resistance, and the creation of the new it's called the Algemene Spaar- en Leefrentekas, the General Savings and Rent Kassie, in 1865 they started. And what we did is we went to the archives of this bank, and the first actual data they have on the accounts of the bank are of 1880. So they start the bank, but they don't start everywhere. And what they actually do is they use the postal offices that happen to be in some places, and in these post offices they open windows of this Sberbank, say, the ISLK. And these post offices, they happen to be where they happen to be. It's nothing to do with industrialization. So it's kind of exogenous to later industrialization, in a sense. So what we know is, in 1880, we know by locality whether there was an ISLK, how many accounts there were per capita, so per population, and how much savings there were on these accounts per capita. So we have a kind of early measure of local financial developments. And this, so we're going to use these two measures of early local financial development. We're going to use the number of ISLK accounts per capita in 1880, and we're going to use the ISLK savings per capita in 1880. This is just, again, to give you an idea. These are the provinces. But again, we have 1,205 localities. I cannot show all 1,205, that makes no sense. So that's why I show the maps every once in a while. But if you have a table, you can't show it in a table. It's too much. So I have averages for provinces, and you see the branch coverage. What is the percentage of localities by province that actually do have a branch of the ISLK? Not many. 16%, 16, 15, 19, 10, but pretty evenly spread, with the exception of Limburg. What is the coverage as percent of population? Very low, actually. What is the coverage, the number of accounts? Not a lot, right? This is in 1880. So what we did is, this is on paper. So we went to this bank, the successor of the successor of the successor of the bank still exists. It was after many mergers, and they have some archives somewhere. And we, so that's, you know, going to the paper, make a photo, and then like this, So it's some hard work for 1,205 localities, but now we have this stuff. At locality level. Okay. Of course, if we're going to do this stuff, if you're going to think about industrialization, one crucial variable we should not forget is the importance of transport or accessibility or distance to market, you could say, and demand. Because in regions with a lot of demand, you could expect more industrialization. So basically, what we're going to do is we're going to control for transport networks. We're going to control for waterways. Do you have a waterway in your locality that is navigable, which have boats? Railways. Do you have a railway station in your locality? Neighborhood railways. So we had a system. It's now completely destitute. It's gone. And usually this system is now cycling paths. In the Ardennes, but we had a neighborhood railway system. You could call it trams, but trams not within a locality, between localities. So there's two small villages and there's a tram running from one to the other. And it was a whole patchwork of neighborhood railways that initially was important. So, and on these little trams, they had some kind of one tram carrying beer, for example. A carriage of beer, a carriage of cheese to the other village. So it was like local trade transport networks. They're now completely gone because we have cars and trucks now, like any normal country. But at that time, there's no cars. There's no trucks, there's no roads, there's just a horse, basically, and the neighborhood railway. So it was very important. And we also control for local welfare, right? Because you could expect if there's more demands, there'll be more industrialization, more commercial industrial activity. So we, how do you control for demand? We look at local house prices. So the land prices are land prices of arable land, not land in cities. It's agricultural land. And we control for house prices. So the idea is if the house price from the cadastre also, we have all the sales, so we know the average house prices. And if the house prices are higher on average, you can assume the locality is more affluent, will have higher demands. That's our best guess. So this is the neighborhood train network, all the connections. It's a bit a mess, right? It's all these small. The west of France, it's here actually. Here. This is, wait, let me look, this is the coast, so should we first have Brussels will be here, Ghent will be here, Antwerp will be here. And this is then the east part of the country. So this will be here will be the Schelde, the big river. This will be France. This will be Germany. This will be the Netherlands. This will be the UK. Right? And this will be the Walloon part. This is Flanders only. So this doesn't look like a train network because it isn't a train network. The waterways, they look like this is the railway network. Eh? It looks more like a network in a sense. Actually, we have it in 1896, not in 1910. That's a typo. And you have the waterways, they really look like rivers, that's good. All the rivers, that's where you have Antwerp. All the rivers coming together in Antwerp, to the big harbor. The harbor of Antwerp is not open till 1865. It doesn't exist before that. So one of the things we want to do in the future, we don't have it at the moment, but one other market potential measure would be distance to Antwerp. If you're closer to Antwerp, to the big port, it should increase your industrialization. We don't have it as far, but the idea was suggested to us last week, so we need to include it in the regressions.
Only to Antwerp, not to Brussels,
not to Liège. But Antwerp is of course a port, right? Brussels is like Moscow. Moscow has a port, but it's not a port. It's like an inland port. It's not for exporting or to the world market. But Antwerp is really a gate to the world market. And at that moment, mainly the UK, the industrial power of the moment. So Antwerp would give access to the UK. So what is so you have already the additional plan. Include the distance to Antwerp to control for simultaneity bias, right? I'll explain why I call this way. So what is the identification strategy? What is the idea? We take the land price, arable lands, agricultural land price, long before industrialization, but with perfectly homogeneous property rights at that time. Everything is there. We take the earliest available local financial development, 1880, which is going to be very exogenous to industrialization, because it's based on the location of the mail offices, which were not chosen to promote industrialization. And we relate it to small-scale industrialization. Well, and big scale, it's like all, but most of it is actually small scale. That's why we call it like this. It's all employment in industry and commerce in 1910 per capita. And the idea is, of course, to avoid reverse causality. It's very unlikely. So initially, the level is the same. So the end level is actually the change, right? The level in 1910 is the change. And it's very unlikely that the change to 1910 influences the land prices in 1846 or the banking in 1880. Still, there could be some simultaneity bias. Maybe it's just in those regions where the market potential is high for some reason, where people are rich, that both have higher land prices in 1846, more bank development later on, and more industrialization in 1910. So maybe the underlying driver is, these are rich regions for some reason. So that's why we control for house prices, and we will also like to control for distance to Antwerp. Maybe distance to Antwerp, if you're closer to Antwerp, you're both going to have higher land prices, although that's not, that can't be true, in fact, because land prices are before Antwerp was opened, but you still could hire financial development. That could be advantageous to Antwerp, so you'll control for that too. So, or in mathematics, this is how it looks, right? So this is what we have in the paper. So the YIT will be the employment per thousand capital in industry and commerce. And actually we have in the tables, I will show this, we have special tables for industry, for commerce, and for industry and commerce. I will show you just industry and commerce, but we also split it off. And we relate this to the land price in T minus 2, actually in 1846. We look at we relate to early financial development. Bank I is the locality always. So locality level T minus 1, financial development in 1880. And we have a set of control variables, early control variables. And of course, the whole idea is the following. We're going to look at this variable. And this is the interaction between the early land price and the early financial development. And what we're going to say, look, that higher land prices and of agriculture lead to higher industrial development is already strange. That higher bank development would lead to higher industrialization is also illogical. But if their interaction, if in those regions where both land prices are high and financial development is high, later industrialize more, that would mean there's a De Soto effect. That's the corollary. So we're interested in alpha 3 and the interaction effect. And if that is positive, if you can't reject as positive, we think of it as evidence that there is a kind of De Soto effect in Flanders. Okay. What are these control variables? So we have a whole set of control variables, early controls. So what do we have? We have the house prices, as I said, in 1865, the first ones that are reliable. So it's welfare market potential. We have the region soil types. So campine is like, campine. It's a soil type. I'm not an agronomist. Loam, polder. Polder is close to the sea, right? Sandy loam. We have accessibility of these localities, every village. So we have waterway access. We have neighborhood railway access. We have railway stations. We have the use of land in 1946. So the omitted category is just agriculture. But you also have fallow, so not used. You have hay. You have grassland. You have garden. We have desolate, so just rough. And you have agriculture, which is the omitted category. You have the share of land in communal property in 1946. In Russia, that would be almost everything, right, at that moment. So you control for the structure of land at the moment you measure the price. We control for size, and we control for the concentration of land ownership. This is the Herfindahl index of land ownership. And the regressions I will show you, it's far too much to show. So in the regressions, I will focus on the main variables. But always, all this stuff is included. I'm just not going to show it because then you got really big tables and it's a mess and you don't care anyhow. It's a control variable. And if you do care, I can show it, yes?
Last four variables.
Yes.
I suppose they were the correct years, 1846, right?
Yeah. Sorry. Oh, yeah. 1846, yes. Thank you. I miss a century here. It happens.
One more question,
I've missed many times, but never a century before. Yes.
What's communal property?
Communal property means it means it's property of the local village, but in many cases that's the old medieval version of land that can be used by everybody in the village. So it's like grasslands, and all the cows can freely graze. So it's communal, but communal agricultural property of the village, which existed. We also had something like the Mir. It was a lot smaller, of course, but you also had communal land property.
Yes,
the commons. So they are commons. So because you would expect that could affect the price, but it will disappear, so you want to control for it.
Okay.
So main results. Is it still readable? Well, more or less. So I skipped a lot of the variables, as you can see. So what do you have? You have first a dependent variable. It's always the same. In this case, the dependent variable is local per capita employment and industry and trade in 1910. So it's industrialization. What are these two columns? It's the measure of financial development. The first three columns, the measure of financial development is the number of deposit accounts per capita, and this is the savings per capita. So it's how many accounts you have and how much Belgian francs you have on these accounts. So if you read these columns, financial development either means this or this. That's how you should read the table. And we are interested in, of course, in the first four. This is the land price, this is financial development, this is the interaction effect, alpha 3, and this is the control for welfare, the house price. So let's have a look. First of all, this is nice. Higher land prices, arable land prices, lead to higher industrialization later on. 60 years later, in fact, 65 years later. So that's interesting and a bit unexpected anyway. You could also say why. You would expect industrialization in those places with lower land prices because it's cheaper to buy the land and put your industry. But remember, this is local industrialization. It's not some foreign investor coming in and buying land. It's all local stuff. You see also financial developments. It seems to be positive. So in those places where the ASLK, this big state saving banks that also give credits, started their operations in 1880, are also those regions that turn out to be more industrialized by 1910. But once you include the interaction with financial developments, you see, interestingly enough, that this is a very strong effect, and that financial development effect disappears. So the early local financial development has no effect on industrialization unless the land prices are high. The interaction effect drives out the main effect of financial development, which is clear evidence of the Soto effect, right? So we are kind of happy with this. You also see waterway access matters, neighborhood railway stations matter, and railways matter big time, which is logical. This is access to markets that drives industrialization. If you're in some region with no railways, no tramways, no waterways, and there's no roads and trucks, you're stuck. That's it. You're dead. You're not going to industrialize. You better move, essentially. You better move to another place. And that changed until we built the road system, of course. Actually, I would also like to look later on at the development of a road system and see how that affected the choices made there, how that affected development. But that's something for later. So these are the main results for 1,205 localities. This is the stuff you wanted to show. Of course, okay, one of the issues is, yeah, but you have financial development. Of course, most of the regions, this variable will be zero. And that's true. We saw that before in the summary statistics of this bank. Most of these localities have no bank. So maybe your effect is just driven by something else, by the choice to have the bank there or not. So that is driving the results. So what could you do? You could say, fine, we will redo this estimate. So either you could have a selection effect. We first are going to calculate why banks are in some regions and then take that into account when doing this. But another option is just throw out all the regions that don't have a bank. We're going to, you have a question? Okay. Go ahead.
This is the overall number of ASLK deposits. So it is reasonable to assume that in 1880, the majority of population in Flanders were rural.
Yes.
So it is most likely the deposits held by rich peasants, landowners.
Yes. 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 I mean, by then it was 85% was rural something. There's actually two cities with some industrialization, which we skip in the data.
Industrialization
is 1910, is later. Yeah. There's actually two cities that started to industrialize by then a little bit, Alst and Ghent, my city, but they're not in the sample. So we exclude them. And all the rest is in the Walloon part of Belgium. So what was I saying? Okay, I was trying to say that the problem could be that this French development is still endogenous. So let's skip all the localities that have no bank. Let's only look at the localities that have a bank. And then it should be not whether you have financial development or not, it should be how much financial development you have. So conditional on having a bank, it will be how many accounts are there and how much money is on these accounts. So it limits the data sets. And instead of 1,205 localities, we have only 186 localities that actually do have this bank, so non-zeros. And you repeat the same regression, and what you find is this. Very nice. First of all, the effect of land is still there, but it's very weak, which is interesting, because I said land could go both ways, right? Why would expensive land be good? It could be actually bad, because you have to buy the land to start a firm. And if you only do land and financial development, it's still there. If you do the interaction with land price and financial development here, you see that the land price becomes insignificant, or almost insignificant. You also see that financial development itself doesn't matter at all. So if you only look at those that the non-zeros, and it's the difference, you see financial development doesn't make any difference, but the interaction effect does. So in a way, the way I read this is, it's actually reinforcement of the de Soto effect. The Soto effect is actually stronger if you look at those guys that have financial development, and you look at how financially developed they are, it really determines how much they will be industrialized later on. So it seems to be mainly the interaction effect and nothing much else, in fact, which is cool. Of course, there's one last thing that you may have forgotten. And the thing that you may have forgotten here is agglomeration effects. Maybe the main driver of industrialization of my locality is the fact that my neighbors industrialize. And that's how it goes, right? So you live next to a village that does very well, you start to trade with it, and you start doing better. So you have these kind of, you could say, agglomeration contagion effects across localities. And interesting, most of the papers looking at this industrialization don't look at all at spatial effects or spatial econometrics. But we think if you take this seriously and you really want to show the de Soto effect, you should take into account that probably the most important driver of industrialization in locality is the industrialization in the neighbors. So what did we do? We thought maybe we should address this. Maybe we should have a spatial Durban model. So some spatial econometrics. It's actually not so difficult to do once you know how to do it. It's kind of doable. And so what you see here is exactly the same regression as we had before. You have the industrialization function of, forget about this, the land price, the early financial development bank, the interaction effect, the control variables, everything remains the same, but the only thing we added is this. And there's a new parameter rho, and there's a W. And the W, what is the W? W is a spatial weight matrix. So what you calculate for every locality, you calculate all the localities within a circle of 20 kilometers, and you give them weights. And the weights are inverse to distance. So a very close locality has a big weight, a very far locality has a small weight, and the sum of the weights is one. So in a circle. So, and basically you multiply the spatial matrix with the, so my financial development is also a function of the financial development in my neighbors, weighted by this spatial weight matrix, allowing for agglomeration effects. So if R is significant, it means agglomeration plays a role and is driving the results, right? So that's what we do. And then if you put that in a regression framework, what you find, these are the spatial results. So, okay, let me, before I show the results, what do? I mean, if you do spatial econometrics, you have to recalculate the weight matrix for every regression. Because if some regression is a missing value, so it should be exactly square. The measure of the weight should be exactly right. So if you do regression and one observation drops out because of a missing value, you have to recalculate the weight matrix, which takes half an hour, and if you have to invert the stuff. So what you basically do, you go for the main regressions, the main results, you calculate, you look what observations you have in these regressions, and for those observations, you calculate the weight that you can actually estimate it. So that's why you limit yourself to the main regressions, but you could do it for any regression you want. And the main regressions are, okay, the fully interacted model, so not the build-up, but the fully interacted model for both the number of accounts and the savings. What do you find? First of all, the de Soto effect is still there. If you spatially weight, the land price becomes very small effect, financial development is gone completely. But the interaction between financial development and land price is still there. It's very strongly, very robustly there. Whatever you do, you can't get rid of it. And also, interestingly, it seems that agglomeration matters, because the rho is significant, especially significant in the second one. So to a very large extent, how much industrialized I am is actually a function of my neighbors. But even controlling for that effect, you still find that the Soto effect plays a big role. So, concluding, I would say that we have some evidence that local industrialization in Flanders is driven by conditional on the presence of uniform land rights, the combination of land values and financial development. So if you have homogeneous land rights, which is not the case in Russia still today, because the land rights actually de facto are very different from region to region, and depending on the local governments. So I would say even today Russia has no uniform land rights system, not really. But if you have a really uniform land rights system, then what we show is industrialization is driven by a combination of higher collateral values and more financial development. In Russia, the problem will also be that many of these farmers, local farms, have no banks close to them. There's no access to finance, even if they would be able to have the collateral. So there's more institutions needed still. So local financial development by itself does not foster growth in localities with low land prices. Because you may have a bank, but if you have no collateral to pledge, you can't get the credits, and you will industrialize less quickly. So it suggests clearly a collateral mechanism of agricultural land, and some we think that implies we cannot reject the De Soto hypothesis that in the presence of land rights, ownership of valuable land improves access to credit and fosters industrialization.
You talked about credits, but as a dependent variable, you use deposits.
There's no data on credits at all. So we don't have data on credits at all. This Azdakau is a Sberbank, and what's actually so. It's an interesting parallel. If you look at the Sberbank in Rostad, in Rostad you will find the Sberbank deposits by region and month, but not the credits. Strange. But unfortunately, it's the same with the bank we have. We do have the deposits, the number of accounts. So we know, however, so that's in the paper, we know that in the Azlakar Bank, there was very little massive refunding of savings to investment somewhere else. So most of the deposits were locally reinvested in terms of lending. But we do not have the lending levels. We do have them for the whole bank, but we do not have them for the localities. So the way we do it is we work with data we have. That's a weakness, in fact. We would much prefer to have the landings. However, in the paper, not in the presentation, in the paper we also have another bank, Raiffeisen, the Raiffeisenkassen. So we have data of all the Raiffeisen banks or local cooperative agricultural banks. And we have data of the Raiffeisen banks of credits, but only in 1910. So it's not really exogenous. That's why we don't really stress it. But if you look at these credits, you see that the credits matter big time, not for actually industrial activities, but very much for commercial activities. So for the farmers that want to develop commercial activities and set up shops and all these kind of things, you see that these Raiffeisen credits really work. But the data is bad because it's very late. We measure it at the same moment as you measure industrialization, so it could be endogenous. So that's why we don't, but it's in the paper. So we have the Azaka Bank, we also have the Raiffeisen results. And yeah, they are what they are. So there we have credits, but it could be endogenous, and we can't solve it. Please.
Sorry, I missed at the beginning of the presentation. If you spoke about that earlier, then I just withdraw the question.
Yes.
The question is, how essential is it to have a bank in your area?
Yes.
Because Belgium is kind of a small country, right? So if in my locality there is no bank, I will drive to nearby and get a loan. And the related question is, if it is important to have a bank in your area, then the bank would have quite a bit of market power if there is just one bank.
Yes.
And Besley and others argue that if credit market is imperfect, if lenders have market power, then the Soto effect would have the opposite sign.
Yes.
The effect would land only to leave borrowers poor so.
Yes.
Because
but
the bank
yes,
would
yes,
have
yes.
Interest rate. So there are two questions. First, the degree of competitiveness, and second, how essential is it to have a bank?
Yes. Let me start with the first or second, but you have to rest them now. But never mind, let me start with the competitiveness. It's a state bank. It's actually a Sberbank. It's a state-owned savings bank, and at that moment it's the only one that is present in these localities. So although indeed there are issues of their incentives, of course they're not profit motivated. And I'm not motivated to extort the farmers. Actually, the whole reason to found them was there was a big financial crisis in Europe in again. 1848, 1849, European crisis, massive bank failures, bank runs, and as a reaction, the government started this public bank. And it was the whole intention to help the farmers, actually. So I think we should put it in the paper, actually, because we have to refute this argument that, look, in our concrete case, it doesn't apply. And then the second thing, do you need a local bank? First of all, I mean, this is very early. So most villages are a village, and there's no road to the next village. It's just a dirt road. So this is very early Flanders. So there's no cars, no trucks. So you can walk to a bank, but it's quickly 15, 20 kilometers. And how will this bank give you credits? Will they trust you? It's to be doubted. Secondly, in this regression, we actually take it into account. Because since we take into account what happens in the neighbors, this is not regression. So yeah, since we take into account what happens in the neighbors, implicitly, it's also calculated. What you could do is the following. Instead of having the W only here, you could also do it here. That's basically would solve your problem. But the problem then is going to be, if you also do it in the interaction effect, it's going to become very tricky to interpret it. But we could do that, actually. So you could say, okay, the problem is that you need a different W, because this W is only looking at the neighbors, but of course here, so you would, one option is to have one bank variable and to have a weight matrix that includes my own locality. Another one would be to have two bank variables. One is my own bank in my own locality, and another would be the spatially weighted banks in the neighbors, and have two bank variables and two interactions. But that makes no sense, right?
It's just one, right?
Yeah. So you need another weight matrix Z or something that includes the own region. That's a possibility. Yeah. We could do that. You should try that.
Just one small correction. Seems to me that it's quite a special Durbin model. Yeah. It's called when they have special axon cost dependent and independent variable. And
yes.
It looks like special autoregressive model.
Say that again. I didn't hear that
term. Special autoregressive model.
Yes. We have actually both. We did the spatial lag and the spatial autoregressive model, and the results are exactly the same. So I show you the lag actually now, but the autoregressive model is exactly the same results. Maybe I should show both. But well. So, okay. Any other questions?
I don't know much about industrialization in Belgium, but what I read from other countries, from other papers and other countries, for instance, in Germany, there are several papers that look at industrialization on a regional level. And what they find is that human capital was one of the main drivers of divergence of regions, because the idea is that countries that industrialize later than England, adopt technologies from technological frontier, and it is much easier to adopt if you have literate population and so on. So
schooling.
What is the role of human capital in your story?
At the moment, it's absent, but maybe it should be there. Of course, you have to. So at this moment, there's not a single Dutch-speaking university in Belgium. Ghent became Dutch-speaking after the First World War, and Leuven became Dutch-speaking in 1968. So there's no access to education, actually, for the whole of Flanders. That's probably one of the reasons why they were so slow to industrialize. But so what I fear is, although you're right, you're not going to have much variation. The schooling is going to be low throughout. And if any schooling, it will be French-speaking. So the people in the villages that don't speak French, they learn to write, and that's it. If they learn to write, yes. But we should look at it. We've tried to find data.
I think you can find data on literacy rates.
Yes. We should be able to do that. Yes.
I have a question. I'm not sure that it's relevant, but still, And just wonder, was there all diamonds in development their property rights?
Mm-hmm.
I'm asking that because Antwerpen was for many centuries before
industrialization. Yes.
It's the main diamond center in Europe.
Yes.
Why I think it's important, first, diamonds are very expensive,
mm-hmm.
and you can use them as collateral,
mm-hmm.
right? Instead of houses, because some diamonds could be even more expensive than
houses.
That's one point. I'm not sure that it's certain, but
mm-hmm.
just in case. And second, I think that people who trade diamonds,
yes.
they have a huge demand for property rights. Not in land property rights, but just in property rights.
Yes.
Probably there is a kind of spillover from one type of property rights to another one. So I'm just interested in whether it could be somehow.
I have never thought of this. It's interesting. We should have a look at it. So, but for the land property rights, I don't think it plays a role, because that's like an exogenous shock of Napoleon, much like this paper of Acemoglu in Germany, right? Where he invades someone. So that's the identification. But it could, of course, be that the attitudes towards property rights or the demands is different in places close to Antwerp or something. So my first answer, I don't know. My second answer would be, if we enclose the distance to Antwerp, I think it should already, to a large extent, correct for it.
Mm-hmm.
Because these people that trade diamonds are going to, the farther they go away from Antwerp, the less likely you will be able to find them, I think. So it should be Antwerp distance related.
But I think what I learned a little bit from the history of the diamond industry is that initially it was in Brussels. The diamond center was in Brussels. They compete with Antwerp.
Yes.
And kind of change in power.
Yes, that's a good question. I don't know. I know it's very Jewish industry in Antwerp, and now it's also more and more Indians, but of course not then. So then it was mainly Jewish, I suppose. They didn't have a bank by then. Now there's a diamond bank, but they didn't have a bank. But of course they had implicit trust-based relations. So it's a relational market, that's for sure. But I have no idea how it affects people. I will look into it. If I find some data, it would be great. I look into that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I have to remember all these good questions. Education, spatial weight, yes.
What about Jews?
Yeah, what about that? I don't know.
So there is a that financial industry in Europe is long related to its Jewish presence.
Yes.
And there is evidence from Germany that those areas which have Jewish ghettos now have less of trust in the international system, so less of control there. Is there a variation in the presence of Jews in Belgium?
Oh yeah, it's zero everywhere except Antwerp, basically. In Flanders, there's very, very few Jews because there are very few cities at the moment. It's very agricultural, and Jews don't agriculture, actually, right? Historically, at the moment, long ago, there was a split. As I remember history, at some point, there was a decision in the Jewish religion that you had to teach your own children at home to read and write and the Bible. They're part of the Bible, so the Old Testament, and the Talmud and all that stuff. And at that moment there was a split, and many people opted out of religion because that requirement was very inconsistent with an agricultural life. Like, kids have to help in the farm. So it seems that then all the people that opted out are city people. So, and that's actually, they call it the split of the temple or something. That's 2,000 years ago. And since then, there's very, very little Jewish presence in agricultural environments. And most, especially in Europe, most have been very, very urban civilizations. So I don't think it should play a big role, because this is really about villages, not about cities. But maybe we should check the census. I think I can find a census and see how many Jews there are, but I think it will be zero mostly. But in Antwerp, not. Yeah.
Any more questions?
Diamond, Jews, education. Yes, I have to write it off. Thank you.